So, once again, good afternoon to all. So, today in the continuation, we will discuss what the next topic. In the last lecture, we discussed about trichoderma in the disease control. Now, today we will discuss about how we can use bacteria as a disease control agent. Okay, so today we will discuss about how we can use bacteria as a disease control agent. To know that why, how bacteria can be used as disease control agent, we should know that what is the use of microbes as biocontrol agents. Okay, what is the use of microbes as biocontrol agents? We know that there are a lot of microbes which we have already discussed. They are used to control many diseases, particularly which is affected mainly in the soil bond. Because we know that normally the plants are infected mainly through the soil. Most of the disease-causing pathogens normally attack on the root, on the soil. Though there are other sources like airborne also, waterborne also, but in the crop, most of the microbes which are causing a disease, they mainly target the soil or the root of the plant. Okay, so many microbes which are used as biocontrol agents for the control of many diseases, mainly they are used against to control the soil-borne diseases. Though they are applicable to control other diseases also, but the key point that basically we use these microbes to control basically diseases which are affected with the soil-borne. Okay, so there are many fungi and bacteria which are used as biocontrol agent. Okay, though no doubt there are various fungi and bacteria. About fungi, we have discussed about Trichoderma, we have discussed about Babyaria babesiana, we have discussed about Metarhizium. And in the bacteria, basically Bacillus subtilis, we know that it contains BT gene, so it is used for the transfer. Okay, this BT gene is used for what? For transfer of certain genes which are insect resistant. Okay, certain bacteria we will discuss in this lecture about other bacteria which are recommended. To state among them, we discuss about Trichoderma, another fungi Glycolidium. We discuss about Empilomyces quisqually, which was used to control the powdery mildew of grape. We taught in the early lectures. Then Agrobacterium radiovector, Bacillus subtilis, and Pseudomonas fluorescens. These are the few more another example which are used as biocontrol agents. Among them, we already discussed about the Trichoderma we have discussed. Okay, we have discussed about Empilomyces quisqualis. We study the mechanism that this Empilomyces quisqualis was used to control the powdery mildew in grape crop. Then we discuss about Agrobacterium radiovector. Then we discuss about Bacillus subtilis. We can also isolate Bacillus subtilis from the soil. Though the protocol is almost same like Trichoderma, but the difference is of media. Okay, so Bacillus subtilis is also another soil microbe which is having the large many applications to use as the biocontrol agent. Okay, so for that purpose, what we will discuss? We discuss about another, furthermore, biocontrol agents. Okay, now we talk about Pseudomonas fluorescens. Okay, now first of all, we would like to talk about Pseudomonas fluorescens. Okay, what is the role of Pseudomonas fluorescens? Okay, so Pseudomonas fluorescens has gained lot of attention. Why? Because it is the important part of integrated pest management for sustainable agriculture. We have already discussed this word in the previous lectures that what do we mean by IPM? Okay, so IPM, integrated pest management, means proper, well-defined, controllable use of different pesticides and herbicides without affecting the toxicity and without polluting the environment. And for they are used for sustainable agriculture. Now I have already told you about what is sustainable agriculture. It means sometimes preservation of food and edible items for the near future, because we don't know what what we going to happen in the near future. It can be flood, it can be drought, it can be earthquake. So what then, what we will do then? So in order to save our future regarding the edible items, we should go for such type of cultures, agriculture, which is used to preserve a certain edible crops and food items to be consumed in the near future with proper economical balance. So that's why Pseudomonas fluorescens has been recommended up to many large extent in the field of integrated pest management for sustainable agriculture. Okay, this statement has been told by Mukhopadhyay since in 1987. After that, lot of work has been done on this bacteria. Like in the last lecture, I told you about bioremediation. Okay, Pseudomonas, some species of Pseudomonas are also used as biocontrol agent. Okay, they are used to degrade the harmful xenobiotic compounds and oil spills in the seawater. Right, Pseudomonas putrida. Okay, so this Pseudomonas, now here we are talking about Pseudomonas fluorescens. I meant to say that the Pseudomonas is very important bacteria to be used as the biocontrol agent. Okay, then see, we will discuss about the basic bacteria, that is Pseudomonas fluorescens, in detail. So first of all, this Pseudomonas fluorescens is a common gram-negative rod-shaped bacteria. Okay, this Pseudomonas is a common gram-negative rod-shaped bacteria. It belongs to genus Pseudomonas. Obviously, Pseudomonas fluorescens is the name. Okay, now this Pseudomonas fluorescens has multiple flagella. Flagella is used for the locomotion of the bacteria. We know that. Okay, it is made up of clatellum, some microtubules, some ATP. So this Pseudomonas fluorescens has multiple flagella, and I told you flagella is the main locomotory organ for the bacteria. Okay, so what are the features? Pseudomonas fluorescens is a gram negative bacteria. It is rod shaped, belongs to Pseudomonas genus. It has multiple flagella which are used for the locomotion. Now another important point, it has extremely versatile metabolism and can be found in the soil and the water. Now Pseudomonas is the only kind of biocontrol agents which is found both in soil and water. Most of the biocontrol agents are found in soil, but Pseudomonas fluorescens can be, it is very extremely versatile. It is having diverse metabolism and it can be found in soil and water. Okay, so it is the only biocontrol agent which is used, okay, which is used both in the soil as well as in the water. So that's why, due to the diversity in the habitat, they have extremely versatile metabolism. Next point, this Pseudomonas is an obligate aerobe. I told you about in the terminology, what do you mean by obligate, what do you mean by facultative. So obligate is a kind of compulsion. So what is an obligate aerobe? It is an obligate aerobe, but certain strains are capable of using nitrate based oxygen. Okay, it is an obligate aerobe. Certain strains are capable of using nitrate instead of oxygen as the final electron acceptor. Right, what I told, it is an obligate aerobe, but certain strains are capable of using nitrate. This is in one of the important in the case of Pseudomonas. What? That they are capable of using nitrate instead of oxygen as the final electron acceptor during cellular respiration. Otherwise, what we read? We read that during glycolysis, Krebs cycle, electron transport chain, there is an electron transfer between oxygen and the electron ion. But Pseudomonas has an important property that if it do not get proper oxygen, it can basically go for final electron acceptor, and it can help in the process of cellular respiration also. Okay, so these are some major features of Pseudomonas fluorescens. Okay, then we discuss about another aspect of Pseudomonas fluorescens, that it belongs to plant growth promoting rhizobacteria. We already know that Trichoderma has the same property in fungi kingdom. Similarly, this Pseudomonas fluorescens, it belongs to plant growth promoting rhizobacteria. It is an important group of bacteria that play a major role in the plant growth promotion. They induce systemic resistance, we will discuss later on. And same way, they control the biological control of pathogens. It means what? Their target is also on the root. They will help in the nitrogen fixation. And thus, they will again control the different kind of plant pathogens. See, it can control the pathogens which are attacking the soil also. It can control the pathogens which are transmitted from water also. So it is having dual property. That's why this bacteria has gained a lot of attention. Many scientists are trying to mass multiply this bacteria because of this wide application. Okay, so this, what I told, it is important plant growth promoting rhizobacteria, major role in plant promotion, induce systemic resistance and biological control of pathogens. Okay, and they are used in the biological control of pathogens. Then we discuss what is the advantage of using Pseudomonas fluorescens as the biocontrol agent. Okay, so this bacteria, it possesses many traits that makes them well suited as biocontrol and growth promoting agents. Okay, so this bacteria, Pseudomonas fluorescens, possesses many traits that make them well suited as biocontrol and growth promoting agents. These include the ability, what is the advantages? The main advantage is that they can grow very rapidly in vitro. Okay, so what is the main advantage? That they can grow very rapidly and they can be mass produced. They rapidly utilize seed and root exudates. Okay, sometimes there is extraction of certain compounds from the plants that can become the substrate for the Pseudomonas fluorescens. So they can, I want to say that they can rapidly utilize the seed and root exudates. Basically, the exudates contain some phenolic compounds, some acids, some flavonoids. Okay. So what will happen once they utilize seed and root exudates? They can rapidly increase their metabolism. After that, they will colonize and multiply in the rhizosphere and spermosphere, environment and in the interior of the plants. It means what? They can easily colonize and multiply in the roots. And what is spermosphere? Spermosphere is that part of the plant which is producing male gametes. That is what? That is anther, style, stigma, means they are localized both in rhizosphere and in the flower also. Okay, because male reproduction because takes place through flower part, that is anther, stigma and ovary. And they are also found in the interior of the plants. So what are the advantages? They can grow very fast speed. They use seed and root exudates. They colonize and multiply in the rhizosphere and in the spermosphere and the interior of the plants. Okay, so they colonize and multiply in the rhizosphere and spermosphere environments and in the interior of the plants. Okay, these are the main advantages. Okay, then another important point. This Pseudomonas produce wide range of bioactive metabolites. These bioactive metabolites are same natural product secondary metabolites which are secreted by this bacteria. So what will happen? When it will secrete these chemicals, no any kind of pest or pathogen can attack on the crop. Why? Because of secretion of these bioactive metabolites. Okay, so this Pseudomonas fluorescens has wide spectrum. Okay, and they can secrete large amount of bioactive metabolites, which includes like cholesterol, flavonoids, sterols, alkaloids, steroids. After that, same competition, same, these almost maximum features are same as of Trichoderma only. Again, they will compete aggressively with other microbes. means what happens in the competition, they will fight for the space and nutrition, and ultimately they will win the battle and they will remove other microbes which cannot fight aggressively. So it is the ultimate winner of the battle. So it will compete aggressively with other microbes. Okay. After that, they will adapt to various environmental stress. Okay, after that, they will adapt to various environmental stress. Okay. After that, they are very inexpensive. Means they are very cheap to use. Okay. It means they are very, very cheap to use. They are very inexpensive. Means they can be cultivated at very low cost and in the minimum cost of labor. So they are very, very inexpensive. Okay. After that, now we discuss what is the exact mode of action of Pseudomonas. Okay, how they can basically react so that the crop can be free of any pest or pathogen. For that, they acquire different modes. Now, what are these modes of action? We will discuss each mode in detail. First of all, we should know what are the mode of action. First is antibiotic production. We will discuss each in detail. Second is siderophore production. Third is induced systemic resistance. Okay. Fourth is competition. Fifth is hydrogen cyanide production. And the last is plant growth promotion and antibiotic production. So overall total, this Pseudomonas fluorescens possess total 6 methods. I will repeat once again: antibiotic production, siderophore production, induced systemic resistance. It is also called as SAR, systemic acquired resistance. Both are same thing. Then competition, then hydrogen cyanide production, and plant growth promotion, antibiotic production. Okay, so these are the basically 6 methods of action of Pseudomonas. Then we discuss about each and every mode of action in detail. The first method is antibiotic production. Okay. This Pseudomonas is very effective antibiotic producer. I told you that it contains many secondary metabolites that act as antibiotics against plant pathogens. They are also called as phytoallergens in the case of fungi. And what are the secondary metabolites? All biological molecules like protein, phenols, flavonoids, sterols, steroids, alkaloids. So what will happen? These secondary metabolites will act as antibiotics against this plant pathogen. So the Pseudomonas, though we know it is a bacteria, but there is one thing which is very unique. What is that? The Pseudomonas has the capacity to produce antifungal compounds. Though it belongs to bacteria, but it can also produce antifungal compounds like ketoconazole, which are fungistatic. Thus, they will inhibit the spore germination and it will cause the lysis of fungal mycelia. It means being itself the bacteria, it can control both bacterial disease as well as fungal disease, because it can produce some antifungal compounds which are fungistatic and they inhibit the spore germination and lysis of fungal mycelia. Okay, so that's why they are having good fungistatic, inhibiting spore germination and lysis of fungal mycelia. So it is a unique property of Pseudomonas that being itself a bacteria, it can act as a novel antifungal agent. Okay, so that has attracted a lot of scientific community to work on this bacteria. Fine, so what I will repeat once again. So I told that it is very effective antibiotic producer. It produces many secondary metabolites like sterols, steroids, alkaloids, flavonoids, etc., which can act as antibiotics. Besides that, it produces antifungal compounds which are fungistatic. Thus, they will inhibit spore germination and lysis of fungal mycelia. Okay, so they produce antifungal compounds which are fungistatic, thus inhibiting spore germination and lysis of fungal mycelia. Okay, Then we reach to next mode of action, that is siderophore production. This mode of action, that is siderophore production, is the unique property of Pseudomonas. Okay, this siderophore production is the unique property of Pseudomonas. Okay, so siderophores are extracellular. Okay, they are what? They are extracellular, low molecular weight compounds. They are having very high affinity for ferric ion. It means, suppose the bacteria gets deprived of iron. In that case, this organ, its name is siderophore, means this compound, it will help to combat the deficiency of iron, ferric ion. So these are extracellular, their molecular weight is very, very low, and they are very high affinity for the ferric ion. It means they complete the fulfillity of ferric ion when there is a depreciation of ferric ion. Okay, so this siderophore, what it will do? It will sequester or will trigger the limited supply of iron in the rhizosphere. Thus, it will limit its availability to the pathogens and ultimately suppress their growth. I mean to say that what will happen when the siderophores will do what? It will absorb all the ferric ions inside their compounds and provide to Pseudomonas. So the pathogens that are attacking on the crop, they don't have the availability of ferric ion. So what will happen? If they don't have the availability of ferric ion, they will not able to perform their metabolism and ultimately they will die. So their growth is inhibited. Okay, so this siderophore sequester the limit supply of iron in the rhizosphere. They limit its availability to pathogens and ultimately suppress their growth. Why? Because they absorb all the ferric ions. When pathogens come for the infection, they don't have this availability of ferric ions. So they will deprive, they will die because of the scarcity of this ferric ion. So that is another mode of action of Pseudomonas fluorescens, that is siderophore production. It is a unique property of Pseudomonas fluorescens only. Okay, this siderophore formation, it is the one of the unique property for the Pseudomonas fluorescens. No any other bacteria or fungi can do this. So it is a unique property of Pseudomonas. Okay. Then we discuss about very, very important term that is we are talking about long time. Induced systemic resistance. Okay, this actually mode of action has been studied from the point of molecular biology. Lot of genes which are responsible to provide such kind of resistance are studied under this. So this induced systemic resistance is also called as systemic acquired resistance, that is SAR. Okay, so this SAR or ISR basically induce the resistance by three mode of action. Again, in the Pseudomonas, this SAR is done by three pathways. First is they secrete some antifungal compounds that we call as phytoallergens. Okay, first they secrete some antifungal compounds which we call as phytoallergens. I told you what are phytoallergens, some secondary metabolites which have the ability to repel the pest or pathogen to attack on the crop. And that phytoallergens includes what? Sterols, steroids, alkaloid flavonoids. Second method, they will increase the quantity of lignin. If there is an increased quantity of lignin, what will happen? There is an increased quantity of phenol. So as a result, they will cause repulsion in the pathogen. Okay, they will cause a kind of repulsion in the pathogens. So they will not affect any crop. So first method is production of phytoallergens. Second method is increased lignifications. Okay. Third method is production of PR protein in the induced plant. PR means pathogen related protein in the induced plant. The third method is production of PR protein in the induced plant. So what we are doing? Basically this ISR or SAR has been done by three methods. That is production of phytoallergens, increased lignifications, and production of PR protein in the induced plants. All these three together contribute to SAR. Okay, production of phytoallergens, increased lignin, and production of pathogen-related protein. This protein has been studied from the molecular biology point of view. The size and the mode of action has been recommended by certain researchers, but still, a lot of work is being done to know the exact mechanism of this PR protein, that how it can help to relate to provide the resistance against pathogens. So this comes under the induced systemic resistance or SAR. Then I am telling, we are discussing about this PR proteins. This PR proteins is called as PR for pathogen related proteins. They are produced in plants in the event of pathogen attack. Okay, they are produced in plants in the event of pathogen attack. They are induced as a part of systemic acquired resistance. Okay, they are part, as I told you in the last slide, that they are part of SAR. Now, what is the mode of action? Suppose there is infection of the crop by certain pathogens. Then what will happen? There is activation of certain genes. Okay, there is activation of certain genes that produce PR proteins. Okay, there is infection of certain genes that produce PR proteins. And some of these proteins are having important property, like antimicrobial, attacking molecules in the cell wall of bacteria or fungi. So once these PR proteins are activated, they will attack the molecules which are already present in the cell wall of disease-causing bacteria or disease-causing fungi. Thus, they are having potent antimicrobial property, means both antibacterial as well as antifungal property. Okay, others may function as a signal that spread news of the infection to nearby cells. Suppose one organ of plant is infected, that organ can provide the signal to whole organs of the plant that I am infected. So infections will also stimulate the cross-linking of molecules in the cell wall. So they will deposit the lignin on the infected part. Okay, once the infection is started, there is a secretion of lignin on a particular area of the cell wall or the nearby area. So what will happen? Once there is a secretion of lignin, it will act as a local barrier. Means the disease-causing pest or pathogens cannot cross over the lignin. Thus, what will happen? If one part is infected, it will provide the signal to another part, all the plant parts, they will secrete lignin, and in response to lignin, all the pests and pathogens which are affecting the plants, they will not be able to cross the lignin deposition. So ultimately what will happen? The plant will remain free from any kind of bacteria or fungi. Means the lignin will act as a barrier, okay, for the spread of the pathogen to other part of the plant. So that is the main role of PR proteins. That is the main role of PR proteins. Okay. So other may function a signal that spread news of the infection to nearby cells. Okay. Then deposition of lignin will do what? Deposition of lignin will provide the signal to the nearby organs of the plant. So what will happen? It will cause the barrier of to enter the barrier of other pathogens and pest. Then what will happen? Then there is plant or the crop will be remain protected from the disease crops. So this, in such a way, PR proteins has its own very important value. So what we discuss about competition, siderophore production, SAR, PR protein, all these are the important features of Pseudomonas fluorescens. Besides that, what we discuss, the Pseudomonas fluorescens is having the property of releasing antifungal compounds. Okay, they are having the property of releasing antifungal compounds. Okay, so it is a very good source of biocontrol agent. Then We reached to the last point, that is competition. Competition is, I mean to say that basically we can say there is a fight between certain species of microbes. Okay. So the Pseudomonas will have, it will fight with other microbes for the space of nutrition. And its favorite site is what? Roots. The favorite site of Pseudomonas is what? Roots. So the Pseudomonas fluorescence preempt the establishment of other rhizospheres, microscorism. Means in the root part of the plant, it will have the very good amount of competition. It will kill, or it will put down, put away all the other microbes. And ultimately, it becomes the ruler, where it will become the king of the roots of the plant. What is the king do? King sits on a specific place, all other ministers work under him. Who is the ultimate winner? King. So we can say the Pseudomonas is a king of the roots of the plant. So the favorite site for the roots of Pseudomonas is the competition. And mainly, I told that they are also found in what? It can also found in water also, it can also found in soil also. But in spite of that, the favorite site is on the roots. Okay. Then we come to about another important property of Pseudomonas, that is, I told you, it acts as the PGPR, that is plant growth promoting antibiotic production. Because Pseudomonas can act as PGPR also, it can produce certain secondary metabolite also. It means what? It is having dual property. So how Pseudomonas help the plants in the germination? So what it will do? It will promote plant growth. It will produce some phytohormones like auxin and gibberellin. Okay. Naturally, it can produce auxin and gibberellin, and they also help to solubilize the phosphate, because normally what happens? Plants are not able to easily solubilize the phosphate. So they require certain agents to do that work. It helps in the solubilization of the phosphate. Besides that, what I told, very important function, they basically release auxins and cytokinin. We know that what is the role of auxins? They include induce rooting, they induce callusing, they induce apical dominance, they induce paranthocarpy. Similarly, gibberellin, it will do what? It will delay the senescence, Richmond land effect, okay, proper abaxial and abaxial germination of leaves, stem, midrib. Okay, so there are all the roles which are played by the, which sometimes what happens, they are providing this auxins and gibberellin to the plant from the artificial mode. We are already provide them from the artificial mode. Like in the tissue culture, we are adding the plant hormones as a chemical. But Pseudomonas has a property that it itself, it can naturally synthesize auxin and gibberellin, which is a very, very unique thing. And finally, it can help the plant to go for the solubilization of the phosphate. Because phosphate, actually, it is said, a lot of studies have been done to understand the mechanism why phosphate is not easily able to solubilize by the plant. So it requires certain bacteria, phosphate solubilizing bacteria, which can perform this function on the behalf of plant. So one of them is Pseudomonas fluorescens. So what I told, it promotes plant growth by secretion to phytohormones, that is auxin and gibberellin. Along with that, it helps in the solubilization of phosphate bacteria. Okay. Then we will discuss about this diagram. This diagram is very, very important. See, this is the plant. This plant has roots. In the roots, Pseudomonas fluorescens is present. So what it is doing? It is providing cooperation for the plant. It is helping in the germination of leaves, fruiting. It is also dispersed in the air also. It is acting, it is showing pathogenicity against disease-causing agents. It is showing pathogenicity against disease-causing agents. But for the plant, but for the leaf and fruit, it is showing cooperation. It helping them to survive. Besides that, it is having the property of competition, means it is throwing out all the other microbes from the root part, and ultimately it will occupy all root spot. Ultimately, it will occupy all root part in the competition. And next important property is antagonism. Means antagonism means secretion of certain compounds. I told you, PR proteins, phytoalexins, lignins. What it will do? It will help in the repulsion of certain pests and pathogens. It will help in the repulsion of certain pests and the pathogens. So this is called as antagonism, means to repel certain pests and pathogens which are killing the crop. Okay, so these are different modes of action of Pseudomonas. Like for the plant, it is showing cooperation. For harmful pathogen, it is showing pathogenicity. For other microbes which are already present on the roots, it is showing competition. For other microbes, it is showing antagonism. For other microbes, it is showing dispersal. For other microbes, it is showing what? Dispersal. So basically, there are 4 to 5 methods of mode of action. So what we have discussed? We have discussed about competition. We have discussed about siderophore formation. Siderophore formation helps to what? It accumulates the ferric ion. So coming pathogens do not have the ferrous. Then we discuss it acts as a very good PGPR. Means it secretes the plant hormones like auxin and gibberellin and helps in the solubilization of phosphate. It is having to induce what? SIR, systemic induced resistance, by production of phytoalexins, lignins, PR proteins. PR proteins are stimulated by certain genes. They are providing the signal to the disease part. What will happen when the other plant parts are knowing that one of our part has been infected? They will secrete lignin. Suppose I know that I get skin infection on my finger. What I will do? I will take the antifungal drug so that the fungus cannot spread throughout my body. Same concept is done by PR protein. They will secrete lignin, and that lignin will not allow the infection of other pathogens to spread on the plant. These are the basic mechanisms which are specially assigned by this bacteria Pseudomonas fluorescens. Because of this property, it has been kind attention by various scientists, okay, to study on this Pseudomonas fluorescens. Okay, then we reach about isolation and multiplication. See, most of the bacteria are produced on nutrient agar medium. They are isolated from the soil. But in the case of Pseudomonas, we have to take special care. But that they are mainly found from the rhizosphere part. We have to take the root part of the plant. Okay, we have to take the root plant of the plant, not from the soil. Otherwise, all other microbes can be easily isolated from the soil. Okay, so we are collecting the Pseudomonas from the rhizosphere. After that, we will go for serial dilution, means increasing the concentration according to the volume. We will select which dilution is the best. We will put the dilution in the plate which is having the media. Now we know that it is a bacteria, it should be grown in nutrient agar media, but no. Pseudomonas fluorescens requires certain specific media because it is like a king, right? Because it is having very good advantages. So it is among the king of all used biocontrol agents. So it requires King's B media. So which media we require? We require King's B media for the culture of Pseudomonas fluorescens. Okay. This King's B media contains nitrates, sulfates, magnesium sulfate, lot of salts are there. So it is not the important point to discuss about the composition of the media. But the name of media is important, that is on King's B media. Further, they can also be multiplied on the King's B broth. Broth, I told you, medium minus agar-agar is called as broth, means the broth is a liquid culture. Why we use broth? Because in the broth, what happens? The cells of particular microbes get, each and every cell gets proper nutrition by the proper rotation. We keep this broth solution on the rotator. When it will rotate, every cell of the microbes can absorb the nutrient which are present in the broth. After that only they can germinate. Okay, so for isolation and for mass multiplication, what we will do? We will collect the Pseudomonas from rhizosphere. we will go for serial dilution. We will take King's B media, and it can be multiplied on the King's B broth media. Okay, it can be multiplied on the King's B broth media. Now, basically, we will know that this Pseudomonas is available in the market by its trade names. Okay, this Pseudomonas is available in the market by its trade names. What are the trade names? Pseudo. Okay, second name is Monas. You bifurcate Pseudomonas, it comes out to be Pseudo, it comes out to be Monas. One botanical name, trade name is Pseudo Monas BioShield, because it is acting as a protection for the plant, and it is a living organism, so we call it BioShield. TNAUFP7. Why? Because this variety has been discovered in the Tamil Nadu Agricultural University first time. That's why they are selling. They have patented the name of this bacteria with the name of TNAUFP7. Then we call it Pseudocon. Then we get called as Powerol. Why Powerol? Because it is the ultimate king amongst all the microbes used. And then we discuss about Biomonas. Then we discuss about the Biomonas, that is Pseudo. So these are the general traditional names of Pseudomonas fluorescens, that is Pseudomonas BioShield, TNAU, Pseudocon, Powerol. The total, they are known by the 7 names. And TNAU is renamed after the discoverer of Tamil Nadu Agriculture University. Okay, it has been renamed after the discoverer of TNAU, that is Tamil Nadu Agriculture University. Another name, Pseudocon, Powerol, and Biomonas. These are the different packets in which it is available. Okay, these are the different packets in which it is available. Okay. So after that, now, which are the target pathogens which are controlled by Pseudomonas? We should know that. Okay, we should know that which are the target pathogens which are controlled by the Pseudomonas. So among them, first of them is Python. Second is Agictonia solanae. Third is Irviana keratovorova. Fourth is Thelvia psoppis basicola. Fifth is Guanomyces graminis via triticae. No doubt, Pseudomonas can control about 50 amount number of pathogens. But specifically, it controls these 5 species. Python generally cause damping off. Rhizoctonia solanae cause wilt. Irvinia. Okay. Thelia webstosis basicola. And Guanomyces graminis via triticae. So these are the main points we discussed today about this bacteria, that is Pseudomonas. So what point today we discuss as a biocontrol agent? We discuss about importance of Pseudomonas, how it plays in the role of IPM. Then we discuss its basic property, gram negative, flagella, metabolism, use of nitrate at the place of oxygen. Then we discuss about as a PGPR. It acts as a PGPR. How? By this process, it grows rapidly. It uses root and seed exudates, found mainly rhizosphere and spermosphere. It has produced large number of bacterial compounds. It has having very good competition, adapt to various environmental stress like humidity, temperature, pressure, pH, moisture. Okay, it is another benefit point that it can adapt to various kind of environmental stress that are protein, that are pH, humidity, temperature, pressure. And they are very importantly, they are very inexpensive. Then we discuss about mode of action, antibiotic production, cytophore production, induced systemic resistance, competition, hydrogen cyanide. See, one point we skipped, that they produce one gas, that is HCN, hydrogen cyanide. Okay, this hydrogen cyanide basically kills, it is having repellent property. This hydrogen cyanide is having repellent property. So it will damage all the pathogens. Okay, so it will damage all the pathogens. Then we discuss it produce antibiotic production, they produce secondary metabolites, they produce antifungal compounds, they have antifungal property. Then we discuss about siderophore, they are what? Extracellular, low molecular weight compounds, which can have the high affinity for ferric ion. Thus, they create the limitation of ferric ion for other pathogens, so they suppress the growth of other pathogens. Then we discuss about SAR by three methods, production of phytoalexins, by increased signification, by production of PR protein. Then discuss what are PR proteins. They are called as pathogen related proteins. They are secreted genetically. How? When certain genes are activated. Suppose one part is infected, they will stimulate the genes to carry out the information that we are having the infection. In response to that, PR protein will activate. Once they will activate, they will produce lignin, which will act as a barrier for the other microbes. Then we discuss about its competition. Then it can produce the PGPR, but it can produce auxin and gibberellin, also helps to solubilize the phosphate bacteria. And these are the five methods: cooperation, dispersal, pathogenicity, competition, antagonism. Then how we can isolate? We can isolate specifically from the rhizosphere. We require certain cyril dilution. And which is the media? Media is the King's bee media. So it can be cultivated on the King's bee media. Then it is recommended by various names like Pseudo, Monas, BioShield, TNAU, Pseudocon, PowerOl, BioMonas. After that, it is fine effective against Pythium, Erectonia, Irvinia, Thaliophopsis, Graminicola, various triticae. So all this was totally, today we discuss about what is the importance of using Pseudomonas aeruginosa as the source of biocontrol agents. So I hope this lecture understand you about the importance of Pseudomonas. Thank you.